All right, welcome. This is week eight. Yeah, this is week eight of engineering ethics at NJIT. It's the 24th of October today. I mean, we're in lesson eight, and that means we're talking about the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. Let me go ahead and jump into the lesson here. So yeah, so we're on lesson eight, Deepwater Horizon oil spill. Let me pull the chat. So this week's lesson is really just about looking at the case. It's a very rich case. There's a lot of stuff in it, a lot of angles of attack. So your job for this week is to go over all the materials I provide, and I've provided a lot of materials. So it's to go over the materials, try to reconstruct what happened in the case as best you can, and then pick some aspect of it, and lots of aspects, pick some aspects to sort of dig your teeth into. And give it a full analysis, both explain what went wrong and also try to give an ethical analysis, who's to blame, how should we hold them responsible, how do we prevent this from happening again in the future. I don't give you any particular writing prompt, you're really just supposed to look around and see something that you're interested in talking about. And what I want to do today is I want to just sort of introduce the case. And then I want to introduce all the resources I have for looking at it. I'm not going to go over everything. There's too much here to go over everything. But I want to point you at these articles and sort of give a little brief overview so you know what to expect. I will say that this lesson is partly designed to prepare you for thinking about your own case studies in lesson 10 and 11. So this is lesson 8. Deepwater Horizon is lesson 8. Next week, we're going to do climate change and geoengineering. So I have some more lectures to give you about the history of temperature and so on. So that's lesson 9. So this week is Deepwater Horizon. Next week is climate change. And then lesson 10 is your own case study, where you're going to be asked to pick some real-world case and give it a full treatment. So in lesson 10, you should do the report on what happened. And then lesson 11 should be your ethical analysis. And you should start thinking about this stuff now. Start picking a case and maybe do some preliminary research. For the assignment, I'm asking that you submit an annotated bibliography along with the case study, where you are going to need four different primary sources or scholarly articles. I also allow investigative journalism, but it has to be serious investigative journalism and not just a news report. So when you're picking a case, make sure that you are picking it with a mind to the resources that you're going to use to support your case, the research that you're going to use. And the Deepwater Horizon case that we're doing this week is supposed to be an example of the kind of resources I'm looking for. So I have a lot of different scholarly journal articles, some primary documents, and some investigative journalism articles. Sort of give you a hint of the kind of research that I'm looking for. You should be thinking now about what case you want to look at, and in lesson 10, I give a big long list of cases: Hurricane Katrina, Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, Hyatt Regency walkway collapse. These are all pretty common cases. I give some other cases. I haven't updated this list in a while. You can see I put this stuff up sort of just after the Chilean mining accident. A couple of these are pretty new. Volkswagen emissions scandal is still pretty new. The GE3, Bunny Greenhouse, John Carpenter, these are all whistleblowers you might be interested in looking up. Something I don't have on the list, but that I was remembering going over the oil spill today, is the big gas leak in California. Earlier this year, there was this massive gas leak, one of the largest environmental disasters of all time, where this rig was releasing methane, something like, I don't know how they measure gallons. I don't know how they measure methane. They're releasing a huge amount of methane. Over the entire course of the leak, some like 97,000 tons of methane, almost 100,000 tons of methane, were released. This leak continued on from October to February, October 2015 to February of this year. January, February, October, November, December, January, February. Yeah, it's like 5 months, 6 months. I don't know much of the details of this case, but I suspect it's going to look a lot like the BP oil spill we're going to do this week. So if you're interested in these kinds of environmental disasters, there's plenty of examples to go around. I also have things like the Pentium FDIB bug, other sorts of computer engineering or computer software problems. The NSA cracks Diffie-Hellman, which is a major security algorithm. It's used in HTTPS, I believe. They also installed a backdoor in the RSA security protocol. Okay, come in. Yeah, no problem. Thank you. So these are all cases that's supposed to give you some examples of the kinds of things I'm thinking you might want to research. If you have other case studies that you know of, other scandals, other whistleblowers, other major disasters that you know about, especially if they're related to your own area of specialty, your own domain of engineering, or if you're not an engineer and you want to find some other kinds of issues related to your field, you don't have to go work from this list. You can find other scandals that you might be interested in. I actually have the Wikipedia list of industrial disasters, structural failures, whistleblowers, other key engineering cases, engineering ethics cases. Don't do a topic that we've already covered in class. Don't do the Challenger explosion. Don't do the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. But if you find some other case related to your own career, that would be interesting. Also, a couple of special topics that probably deserve more discussion in class, but that we haven't, haven't really fit into class. Sexual harassment and discrimination is a constant workplace issue, not just for engineers, but for everyone who works in a workplace. And I don't really talk at all about the ethics of sexual harassment or discrimination, but these are both real problems that you will definitely face in your career. You might face it directly, or you might see it in your peers, your colleagues. So if you instead of talking about some major engineering disaster or a case of ethics, if you want to talk instead about sexual harassment and discrimination, or the other issue that I have mentioned here is things like gift giving and bribe taking. A lot of the NSP code of ethics is designed around the ethics of accepting and receiving gifts or giving gifts. And when that crosses over into bribe territory. So if you are interested in this kind of stuff and you want to think more about gift-giving, bribes, and the ethics related to that, feel free to use this research project as an opportunity to do some research on those issues. If you pick these issues, I'm still going to need sources, primary sources or scholarly journal articles. But the idea is for it to be sort of wide open so you can pursue your interests and how this class intersects both with your career and your future interests. I hope that makes sense. I hope if there's any questions, just ask or leave a question in the chat. I remember week 10, you have to give your own case study analysis, and then week 11, you're doing the ethical analysis. So this is a big project from you. I will still, at the very least, I will have a class for lesson 10, and we'll talk a little bit about it. Just make sure that everyone is oriented on the project again. Lesson 11, we might skip the lecture. I'm not sure. But I'll let you know again when we get to lesson 10. All right.
The resources we're allowed to use? Like what qualifies as a primary source for scholarly journal?
Yeah, good. So I have, on the website, I have some clarifying websites that explain what a primary source is, what a investigative journalism article. Oh, that link is broken, I guess. This is about the difference between scholarly publications and popular publications. Popular publications are from news magazines like Time Magazine or People Magazine. Most opinion-based journalism, either opinion-based journalism or sort of news, current events kind of journalism, where they just report on some event that's happening. It's very easy to find news reports on the oil spills, but those aren't scholarly publications. Scholarly publications are published in a journal, in a scholarly journal, a research journal. It's usually peer-reviewed. scholarly publications are usually academics, and they, first of all, the standards of argument, standards of evidence are a lot higher than in popular publications. And there's also peer review, so there's some sort of check on the accuracy and the integrity of the pieces. So look for scholarly journal publications, and the easiest way of doing this is either going to the NJIT library. Just about anything you find at the library will be okay, apart from their periodical section. Or even easier, to go to Google Scholar. So scholar.google.com is another search, but you can... search for different things, just like regular Google search, but this only returns to you scholarly journal articles. So everything here is going to be a scholarly published article that'll be just fine for our purposes. Yeah, this is published in Physics Teachers.
Do we need a certain amount of each one, like two primary sources and two scholarly journals? Or?
Yeah, good. No, you don't. You just need to have four good sources overall. And so the scholarly articles tend to be analysis, more analysis than investigation. And that's fine. If you have four articles that are just ethical analysis of the case, that's fine. Usually, your investigative journalism articles or your primary sources are where you're going to get most information about what actually happened at the event. So a primary source is the original documents pertaining to some issue. So like a video or first-hand witness accounts. Another kind of thing that counts as a primary source are government documents. So for instance, after the Challenger explosion, there was the report. I forget the name of the report. I want to say Warren report, but that's not right. After the Challenger explosion, the government set a team to do an investigation, and then they write up the report as an official document submitted to government. And that counts as a primary source. Those are primary resources that those articles are coming up with. And I'll show you an example of this with the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. So in the Deepwater Horizon oil spill case, I'm trying to give you examples of all of these kinds of documents. So the two documentaries, have a lot of interviews with experts and with sort of firsthand witnesses, with people directly affected by the issue. These interviews and these documentaries are the only sources for this commentary from the original sources. In this sense, these count as investigative journalism articles and as primary sources. The Ingersoll article also gives you, I'm going to talk a lot about the Ingersoll article in just a few minutes, but one of the things that it gives you in the Ingersoll article are the actual emails being sent by engineers on the Deepwater Horizon oil rig as they're deciding what to do in the lead up to the disaster.
So this is considered investigative journal?
These emails are themselves primary documents. And so the Ingersoll article, it's a report. It was written by MIT Sloan Foundation, but it was a report on the... they have access to primary documents. In this document, you have access to primary documents. It's really a scholarly article, but the resources that you get from this article are primary documents. Like those emails, right? Those emails are the direct, it gives you direct insight into what happened, because those are the engineers making that decision in those emails. Sorry. If you have questions about a source, or if you have questions about a case that you're thinking about but you don't know what to do with it, or if you don't know this, if a source counts as a good source, send me an email. Just send me the source, and I'll give you my take.
Okay, sounds good. And there's ways to document, like a video you watch, or I guess an APA style that.
Yeah. Yeah. Find the original citation for that document. The Tacoma Narrows bridge collapse, for instance, was caught on camera, and that video has an official citation. I can't think of it offhand, but someone made that video, they get credit for that video in your citations. I don't remember if I mentioned this earlier, but one of the great reasons to use Google Scholar is because it does the citations for you. So here's a scholarly journal. Oh, no, I guess not. Find this. No. Yeah, so here's a scholarly journal article. This looks like it's just looking at the physics of how the bridge collapsed. But it's a journal article, and the great thing about Google Scholar is that you can do citations, and it automatically gives you the full APA citation. I've been asking you to do citations for your assignment so far, but I haven't been really picky about citations. But I do plan to be picky for the for your own research project, and I'm going to be picky in a bunch of ways that I'm usually not picky. I'm going to make sure that all your citations are appropriate or correct because your annotated bibliography is a big part of your grade. And I want them to be actually correct. So I've seen this a bunch of times. Sometimes you might have like an app on your browser that'll get a citation from a page. And often these are wrong. I don't know if I can find a bad citation somewhere. This
is indented at some point. Right, don't you have to indent the second and third line? You know, any line after the first.
Yeah, the indentation. I'm not going to worry so much about the white spacing and that the spacing is all correct. But the things that are important for a citation, no matter what style, the important things are that you have the author's name, that you have the title, and that you have the year. With the name, title, and year, you can usually look up what's going on. And the thing is that it's often the case that these little browser extensions that you use to get the citations, they often can't find a year, and so they put ND in parentheses here. And I often see when students turn in these annotated bibliographies that they have a lot of citations with ND for dates. And that's wrong. When it says ND, that means no date. And almost every source you're going to use is going to have some date. So if your citation says ND in it, that means that citation is not correct. So if your citations are missing author, year, or title, then you're going to lose points on that. If it's not a scholarly journal article, you'll lose points on that also. I should also mention, I might have mentioned this before, but I do strict plagiarism checking. I usually check for plagiarism a little bit, but I don't do as strict testing. But for the research project, I'm going to check everyone's essays for plagiarism. And I usually catch lots of people for plagiarism. The penalty for plagiarism is failing the assignment, and multiple cases of plagiarism get referred to the dean. So please don't plagiarize on this assignment either.
Will there be an opportunity for, like, let's say, you're really strict with the bibliography and we lose a lot of points, will there be an opportunity to resubmit?
No. If you're worried about it, send it to me beforehand and I'll give you the okay, or if I'll tell you if anything needs to be revised.
Okay, that's fair.
When you're citing, I know this is main thing is analysis, so it's more of you want to keep. I mean, I know we have to have a four cite as a limit as the minimum, but when we're citing, you don't want to cite a whole lot. You want more focus on the analysis, correct?
I want you to cite anything that you use in preparing your article.
Okay.
So if you use a bunch of Wikipedia pages, put those in your reference list.
Okay.
For your annotated bibliography, I want four scholarly articles or primary sources where you give the citation and then you give a little annotation, explain what's going on in that article, why did you use it. But you only need to do that for four of your sources. If you looked at 10 different sources And a lot of them are like Wikipedia pages, but some of them are scholarly articles. Do your annotations for the scholarly articles, and then just a big list of all the other resources you use. You don't have to put any commentary on the rest of it.
You said something about writing a little summary about why we used it. Like, is that part of the bibliography? Because I've never done that before.
So these are called... go ahead, I'm sorry.
If that case, are you using Chicago or...
APA style.
APA, yeah, Chicago, okay.
So the assignment is for an annotated bibliography. So an annotated bibliography is the citations with annotations, and the annotations are supposed to be a little explanation of the value of that source for the overall project, right? So what information did you get from this source that you couldn't have gotten anywhere else? What is this source adding to the overall project? And the idea is that you want to make sure that you're getting good information from the right sources. So tell us annotated bibliographies are useful when you're doing research. So that way I don't have to read everything in your bibliography because you've sort of explained what's important from the different sources. And so I can just look where I need to if I'm researching your work.
Do you have an example of one?
Yeah.
On hand that we look at?
Yeah, there's one on the, So this is on the lesson. I have a link to the Wikipedia page on annotated bibliographies. Okay. And here's an example. So the bibliography, citation, and then just a little paragraph, a couple of sentences about what's going on in this book, why it's useful, and what information in particular did you get from this source that you were using in your essays.
So does this include, like, is this the bibliography and the annotated bibliography in one?
This is the whole thing.
All right, so we'll have four different blocks that look like this, and you don't have to have a bibliography and an annotated bibliography. It's just all one thing, right?
Yeah, it's just all one thing. That's right. So if you have four citations with little paragraph explanation, and then all the other sources underneath that, that's fine. And remember, I'm only asking for two of the annotated bibliography citations completed for lesson 10 and then two more for lesson 11. So it's really, you only need two each week. So it's four overall, but two each week.
With this style, these are going to be located on whatever, like if on page two we source, we cite this, then we write that little annotated bibliography on the bottom in the more, in the more.
Yeah. So this is all going to be posted on the website. Mm-hmm. And let me go to one of my old semesters to show you. Just picking someone at random here. What I'm asking you to do. So here's his essay, and then after the essay is his bibliography. This person did it wrong because they put it in different. So there's the person's essay, and here's the bibliography, where they have as the first reply in their essay.
Yeah. Are we supposed to put it in as a reply, or don't we just put it in as part of our post?
No, I'm asking you to put it in as the first reply because it's going to get separate. It's going to get graded separately, so I want to be able to put separate points on it. Yeah, so that's one of the requirements on, and all these details are made very clear in the assignment. Yeah, so put your annotated bibliography as a first reply in your thread. There's a penalty for not doing that. So here's her post. That's all her information, and then here's her first reply, and she gets a grade for that. And I just wanted to point out that this is a good example of a bad citation where ND. It really shouldn't say ND. There's a year that this came out, and she just didn't put the year there. So make sure you're looking for the specific citation, that the citations are correct. Okay, I'll talk about this a little bit more next week, and I'll talk about it again in some detail on week 10, on the Monday of week 10, when we start the assignment. Let me go ahead and jump into Deepwater Horizon. Like I said, my goal here is not to tell you all the details that you need to know for Deepwater Horizon, I really just want to introduce you to the case, give you sort of first pass on the case. Yeah, so Deepwater Horizon oil spill. It took place in the Gulf of Mexico. It was one of the largest oil spills in history. Something like 5,000 barrels of oil a day leaked from the wellhead, and it leaked 5,000 barrels of oil a day for something like 90 days, for 3 months. The gusher started in April 2010. They had it capped in July, but it really wasn't sealed until September of the same year. So 5,000 barrels a day for several months. We're looking at something like 5 million barrels of oil spilled over the entire oil spill. And it wasn't just the oil spill, but it was all the stuff that we used to clean it up. Had a huge environmental impact. Collapse of ecosystems, all the fishing and shrimping communities on the Gulf Coast don't work anymore because their fish aren't around anywhere. Some of the largest fines in history, BP ended up paying well over $40 billion in the cleanup effort, and then with all the lawsuits afterwards, they're looking at something like $60 billion of fines and settlement fees. $60 billion is a lot of money. Even for a company as big as BP. Maybe I should clarify that specifically. BP has an operating revenue of something like $225 billion a year. They're losing money right now, in part because of all the cleanup effort and all the settlement fees. $22 billion is not a whole lot of $200 billion, a tenth of it. But I mean, a 10% of your overall revenue, overall assets, it's a big deal. BP is British Petroleum, so it's a British company. So in addition to all these fees, they were also BP was also charged and pled guilty to 11 counts of manslaughter and reckless endangerment of lives. So 11 people died on the explosion when it happened. Let's just go ahead and talk about the explosion. First of all, Deepwater Horizon is a deep sea oil rig designed to operate in deep, deep waters. The oil rig sits on top of the ocean, and the oil well is on the ocean floor, and that's about 4,000 feet, almost a mile, like 3/4 of a mile, below the water, just to get to the wellhead. And the wellhead is on the ocean floor, but the drill keeps going down about another 6.5 miles below the ocean floor. 6.5 miles below the ocean floor, they're drilling. That's deeper underground than planes fly in the sky. It's a huge effort, a huge engineering challenge. It's also incredibly expensive to do something like this. Deepwater Horizon was supposed to be on this drilling operation for 51 days, and it was supposed to cost almost $100 million to operate it over those 51 days. It ended up being, when it exploded, it had been underwater for 80 days, so it was way over time, and it was also way over budget. We'll read that in the Ingersoll article, not only was it over budget and over time, but it was also way behind repair schedule. It was originally estimated, so the BP doesn't own the rig. The rig is owned by a company called Transocean, and they contracted out to BP for $500,000 a day for the rig. It was originally estimated that the rig would be out on this well site for 51 days, costing about $100 million. But by April 20th, when the rig exploded, it had been on there for 80 days. And it was also far behind its repair schedule. I'm looking for the... Yeah, so this is the Ingersoll article. Ingersoll article also documents all the safety issues, both at BP generally, and in fact, quite a number of the safety fines that were being issued, the OSHA fines were being issued to BP. It's something like 97% of the OSHA fines. Yeah. Between June 2007 and February 2010, 97% of the willful safety violations by an oil refinery were handed down from OSHA to the two BP-owned oil refineries. In other words, BP has a long track record of not meeting the safety standards and being in violation of safety standards. And that's just for BP generally, in particular this rig. So here's in 2009, so the disaster happened in April of 2010. In 2009, there was a safety audit. The audit identified 390 repairs that required immediate attention, or require more than 3,500 hours of labor to fix. So that was known in 2009. So the disaster happens a few months after that. And it wasn't dry docked at any point during that time. It was way over schedule already. In fact, it hadn't been dry docked for repairs in 9 years. So it was way over schedule for repairs. There were known safety problems on board. This is part of the reason that BP was found criminally negligent for all those deaths. But let me back up and remind us that these deep sea oil mining expeditions are huge technological challenges, very difficult, very expensive. Let me okay, so this is an XKCD, Lakes and Oceans. I'm going to go ahead and click on this. So this is a graphic designed to give you a sense of how deep this stuff is. So this graphic goes all the way down to 10,000, 12,000 meters. These little lumps right here are the Great Lakes, Lake Ontario, Lake Huron, Lake Michigan. And they don't get more than 1,000 meters deep. Here's the Burj Khalifa. It's the tallest building that we've built. That's how tall it is. Titanic. So this is the ocean floor the Titanic's on. It's about 4,000 meters deep. And that's about where the ocean floor is here. Yeah, so... This is just to give you a sense of the... depth here. So these are all nuclear submarines. Nuclear submarines really can't go deeper than about here, less than 1,000 feet, 1,000 meters deep. Blue whales sometimes go deeper and sometimes dive super deep. We don't really know why. But there's the ocean floor. The deepest part of the ocean is the Marianas Trench. Marianas Trench is a little over 10,000 meters down. James Cameron took his submarine down there a while ago. But Marianas Trench is not like a narrow trench. It's actually a big valley on the ocean floor. It's just the thinnest part of the crust right there. And that Marianas Trench is deeper under the ocean than the largest mountain is tall. It's comparison, tallest mountain. Okay, so it's some discussion of how deep things are in the ocean. So here's the comparison for Deepwater Horizon. There's Deepwater Horizon. There's about 4,000 meters down the oil well head, and then another 6 miles down to the oil that we're actually drilling. So that's 6 miles, much deeper than the Marianas Trench, much deeper than the lowest point that we know about. The only thing comparable is the Kola borehole. So the Russians decided that there was nothing better to do than just dig a big hole, and they dug a big hole that was slightly bigger than the Deepwater Horizon oil well is drilling. The Russians, when they got this deep, they couldn't really go any further because their drill bits kept melting as they kept trying to dig deeper. So this is about the limit that we can dig, and these Deepwater Horizon oil wells are digging about that deep. It's a huge technical challenge to do something like that, like this. For one thing, we can't even operate down at the wellhead. The wellhead is already so far under the ocean surface that we can't put people down there to do any work. All the work that's done is done by robots. We have little ROVs, little roving robots that are remote controlled that can manipulate things down there. Yes, this picture is linked on Moodle. This is the XKCD Lakes and Oceans image. So at this wellhead is where all the action happens. So here's another image. There's the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. There's the riser that takes it from the oil rig down to the wellhead. And at the wellhead is what's called the blowout preventer, the BOP, blowout preventer. And then the pipe digs all the way down into the oil down at the bottom. So the BOP is a blowout preventer, and the blowout preventer is designed to prevent oil spills. If there's a leak, if something goes wrong, the blowout preventer is supposed to be the last safety step to shut things down. So the blowout preventer looks like this. There's a person for scales. It's a huge piece of machinery, a huge piece of equipment. And it's designed to protect the well head on the bottom, right? So the well head on the bottom here is where the drill goes through the ocean floor. And then here's the pipe that comes up through it. The pipe is a bunch of valves and so on that helps the oil flow, helps the drill fluids and so on work. So this device, it's called the blowout preventer. And the idea is that it's supposed to prevent a blowout. If something goes wrong with the drilling, if oil starts spewing back up through the hole in the floor, the blowout preventer is supposed to stop any damage before it gets too bad. What the blowout preventer does is has all these rams on the sides that if there's damage, if anything goes wrong, these rams are supposed to pinch the pipe closed. They have four of these blind rams, and then there's a shear ram. Shear rams is the last bit of protection. You see examples of how these rams. So there's a bunch of rams, including this shear ram, and it's supposed to squeeze the thing shut. They're digging. There's a blowout. Gas ends up spewing back up to the rig, and there's an explosion on the rig. The rig explodes. It burns for a few days. I shouldn't have done that. Oops, sorry. That video crashes my computer every time. Yeah, so there was a fire on the rig. They tried to put the fire out, and they didn't successfully put it out. A few people died. And then the rig goes underwater. When all this bad stuff started happening, the rig starts going underwater, they set off the blowout preventer designed to stop an oil leak. But the thing is that the pipe, the riser that was going into the blowout preventer, was not centered. It needs to be centered in order for these pinching shears to actually clamp off the pipe. But the pipe was off-center, so these shears didn't actually clamp it shut. So the blowout preventer failed and was still leaking oil. The rig went underwater, and so the pipe, so it was sort of half-connected to this improperly sheared pipe. And so the oil leaked not only through the blowout preventer, but it leaked all the way through the pipe to where the rig was under the water. And it continued to barrel out about 5,000 barrels of oil a day, of crude oil a day, into the ocean for several months because no one at BP or anywhere else really had any idea how to fix it. In particular, there was no plan on the books. They had no plan of action whatsoever for what to do if the blowout preventer failed. Uh, they had no plan for what to do with the blow if the blowout preventer failed. So there's a lot to talk about here. Let me start with the Ingersoll article, which I've been looking at a little bit already. The Ingersoll article is going to give you the best overall picture of what happened leading up to the collapse and what happened in the decision-making when the disaster happened. So I strongly recommend you look at the Ingersoll article. In particular, it goes over the entire chain of command, who is in charge of drilling operations, and who is in charge of who, and all of these people, how long they had been there and how they were making their decisions. All these people are people that were involved in this email exchange where they're talking about what to do. So the issue was that the issue was this centering. What was the centering of the pipe? So in order for this pipe to stay centered, and remember it's like a almost a mile long pipe, in order for it to stay exactly centered in these shears, you need these things called centralizers. And one of the engineers had run models of their project and had determined that, so the criterion was 15.06 ppg, I'm not exactly sure what that number means. But that was the threshold they needed to be under, and they had six centralizers, and the guy couldn't make the model work with only six centralizers. The model that he got to work that was underneath the limit is 4.7 ppg, and to get it under 4.65 ppg, they needed 20 of these centralizers. They had six of these centralizers, and it was over the limit. They needed 20 of these centralizers. The thing is that these centralizers would take something like 10 hours to install. Not only would they take 10 hours to install, but they didn't have the centralizers on hand. They'd have to go back to Houston to get them and then fly them over. It would take another couple of days maybe before these centralizers were installed, before they can continue drilling. They knew that they needed these centralizers for the thing to be safe, right? They had run the models and everything. But when they told them that this would be the time delay, the managers, the people in charge of making the decision, were like, no. 10 hours, that's not what we decided on. That's not what we were envisioning. I'm very concerned about that. Right, so it wasn't just the cost, but it was the time. And they didn't want it. They were already over budget. They were already over time. So they just wanted to do it with as little as possible. So they said they don't understand the centralizing requirements. They thought they didn't need the centralizers. And so they got rid of the centralizers. Having no centralizers made the shear rams not work when there was a disaster, and then the whole thing collapses. And again, they didn't have any contingency plan. They didn't have any plan in place for what to do in this kind of worst case scenario. This is talked about quite extensively in this Hook article, worst case in the Deepwater Horizon blowout. There ought to be a law. You might think that if you're going to do a dangerous project like this, you ought to have in place some plans of what to do if things go wrong. And in fact, there was, for the very longest time, there was a law that required large engineering projects like this to have a worst case scenario plan. In other words, if everything that could go wrong did go wrong, what do you do? It used to be the case that when you have these big projects, when these were approved by the EPA and other environmental regulatory agencies, that a condition for approval was having a worst case scenario plan on the books. You don't expect the worst case scenario to happen, but in case it does happen, you have a plan. The thing is that businesses don't like worst case scenario plans very much. To do a worst case scenario plan, the business has to put themselves in the worst light possible. You know, if they make every single mistake, if they bumble every part of the process, what happens? And businesses don't usually like to present themselves in such a negative light. They prefer to, you know, focus on the positives, ignore these negatives. And that means that businesses have not liked this worst case scenario law for a long time. Instead, they've advocated for a typical case scenario. So not if everything could go wrong, if everything that could go wrong does go wrong, what would happen? But what's likely to go wrong? Yeah, it's too much money to, Glenn says it's too much money to do the worst case scenario. Let me clarify that they weren't required to prepare for the worst case scenario. They were just required to have a plan. They didn't have to have all the ingredients for that plan ready to go at any time. They just needed to have some plan on the books, a report that explained if everything goes wrong, here's what we would do.
Well, who's to check to say that plan actually works? Or they could, any company could just make up a worst case scenario and say, we'll do this, but they won't actually say, you know what, this plan may not really work. Maybe 33% says it may work, and then 66, you know, that's not good. It's too risky, so.
Yeah, right. Good. So the idea is that they present their worst case scenario plan, and then the environmental regulators, in particular like EPA, when they're evaluating whether to let this project go through, they also look at these plans and see, you know, are they realistic? Is this something that can actually happen? But you're right. What counts as a worst case scenario? An asteroid could strike in the middle of a hurricane or something. You can imagine all sorts of worst case scenarios where things are really bad, and who knows what you're supposed to do in those cases. So businesses don't like these worst case scenarios. What they would prefer instead are typical case, right? So what's likely to go wrong, and what do you have prepared for the likely events of disaster? And in this case, they're fine to talk about likely scenarios. If something goes wrong on the rig, it might cause a leak, and so we'll have a blowout preventer to protect that leak. Right, the blowout preventer was supposed to be their likely case scenario, and again, they had no plans whatsoever on the books for what to do if the blowout preventer failed. That was their contingency plan. That was their fail-safe. So when the blowout preventer fails, what do you do then? And BP didn't know. They didn't have any idea. So for months, this thing is leaking, and for literally a month, it's just trying to figure out what we can do. They had to call in experts from all over the place to come think about this, and even the experts were like, "This is way worse than anything I've seen before. I have no idea how to do this." We were talking about large oil spills earlier. I don't know if we talked about it. Let's talk about some oil spills. The Deepwater Horizon oil spill is one of the worst oil spills in history. It's probably not the worst. Something like five million barrels of oil.
I remember the Exxon Valdez when I was a kid. That was notorious.
Yeah, so the Exxon Valdez was a tanker. And it was up in Alaska, and the tanker ruptured and spilled its oil all over the Alaska Gulf. And part of the problem there was that it was really hard to get any of the cleanup equipment crews up into the Arctic to actually do work to clean the stuff up. But Exxon Valdez, it was a big oil spill, and it wasn't anywhere near as big as these. Here's Exxon Valdez. It spilled something like 11 million gallons. So like 900,000 barrels. So the Deepwater Horizon oil spill was 4.9 million barrels. So like five times as bad. It's like five times the Exxon Valdez. The methane leak in California this last year is about the same size as Deepwater Horizon oil spill in terms of sheer tonnage of oil, except methane isn't a crude oil, it's a gas, and it's a greenhouse gas. In fact, it's one of the worst greenhouse gases. We're all next week, we're going to be worrying about global warming and rising temperatures and so on. And we've made it a lot worse from these oil spills. And also in the California oil spill, they just didn't know what to do. They just didn't have an idea of how to stop it from leaking. And it took months for even to come up with an idea. But again, neither of these are the worst oil spill in history. The worst oil spill in history, by far, was the Kuwait oil fires. This was after the first Iraq war in the early 90s. These are the oil fires. So if you remember the first Iraq war, there's Kuwait. Kuwait is this little Gulf Coast country, and it's a very small country, but it's right at the tip of the Gulf Coast. and it's really important for exporting oil. And we're friendly with Kuwait. And we weren't so friendly with Iraq. And Iraq didn't like us very much. And so Iraq attacks Kuwait. It attacks Kuwait because it wants access to the ports and so on in Kuwait. And we get mad. The United States goes in to defend Kuwait. And we don't really attack Iraq. What we do is we just push Iraq out of Kuwait. And it's successful. It's one of the more successful military campaigns we've engaged in. And we're successful at pushing Iraq out of Kuwait. But as the Iraqis are leaving, they rip up all their oil rigs and just set fire to them all. Let me go ahead and pull this up. This is one of my favorite pictures because it's just so horrifying. I think this is in Kuwait. That's an engineer about to light an oil well on fire. Something like 700 oil wells spewing oil at this rate were lit on fire by the Iraqis as they retreated out of Iraq. And this stuff spilled for months. Months and months and months of just burning oil wells like that. And stopping a burning oil well like that is very difficult. You can't just douse it in water. Water doesn't stop oil fires. What they had to do was they built these big, they reworked jet engines, and they have this big rig with like airplane jet engines on it. And the idea is to suffocate the fire, is to blow so much air at it that the fire can't get any oxygen. So they smother the fire to put it out. I mean, they had to wheel these big jet engines to each one of these fires. It was a huge effort, and again, it took us months and months. The fire started in January and February of 1991, and they lasted until November.
You know why the guy was setting it on fire? Why was that better than just letting it blow out the liquid?
Setting it on fire so no one else could use it. I mean, it was a big fuck you to everyone. If you want to come in here and start a war for this precious oil, where here's your oil, just light it on fire. The Kuwait oil fire is one of the it's a mind-boggling environmental disaster. The amount of black smoke that just went into the atmosphere for months, these things were burning like this.
With the jet engines, how long did it take to be into effect? Like you said, it ended in November on the top of this article. Mm-hmm. When did they actually start using it? And did it take like months for the jet engine to be installed and then it was used, in a week it worked? Or?
Yeah, good. An individual fire might be put out really quickly. Yes, this is an example of it. So it might take just a few hours to put out an individual fire, but there's hundreds of these things, and it's really dirty work. So it took a long time to go through all of them and put them out. Yeah, so they're extinguishing it.
Okay.
Yeah, and this thing is on like big tank treads.
So it's like no more than a day, basically.
Yeah, but there's 700 of them, so it's going to take
No, but as long as it takes quick to at least put one out.
Yeah. Good. All right. So I was talking about Kuwait. Okay. These oil spills are really big. There ought to be a law. So there was a law. There was a law that demanded that EPA regulators. That any big project like this had a worst case scenario contingency plan in case something like this happens. And there was no such plan for the Deepwater Horizon oil spill. When the blowout preventer started leaking, they called in a bunch of people to try to fix it. They didn't really know what to do for quite a while. I'll look at this. There, Yeah, so it starts blowing in April. And it's not until May that they tried the top kill. Yeah. After about a month, it takes about a month for them to figure this out. After about a month, they have an idea, and the idea is it's called a top kill. And what they want to do is take this big, it's basically a big crate, a big metal container, and drop it over the top of the blowout preventer. The idea is that if you take this big container, drop it over the top of the blowout preventer, and then you can cap the top of the container, and then the whole spill is contained. So this is the idea, is to drop a little container on the top of it. So it takes them about a month to figure this out and find the right equipment to do it all. And then they drop it down, and it doesn't work. It doesn't work because when they drop it on top of the oil, enough oil was collecting, and it's so far down in the ocean that it was crystallizing. And so by the time you got the container over the blow-up preventer, it was already full of a bunch of oil crystals, and so you couldn't actually fit it over to the top of the blow-up preventer. So the one idea that they have after a month of work fails, and it's another few weeks before they are able to try a new version of it that actually works. It's pretty depressing to watch this, and the entire time you're thinking there ought to be a law to prevent them from doing this kind of dangerous stuff, or at least be prepared to deal with disasters. And the point here is that there was such a law, and the lobbyists were able to successfully get rid of that law, to argue that law down until it didn't have any teeth. BP regulators, right, regulators from the energy industry, from the oil industry, who want to get rid of these harsh regulations so that they're more free to do whatever they want. I didn't mention this at first. These kinds of oil rigs it's really expensive to run, it's really dangerous, and it just wasn't worth it for a long time. The thing that made it worthwhile was in the early 2000s when oil prices started jacking up, and gas went over $4 or whatever. Once gas was that expensive, then it became economically viable to do these very dangerous deep sea drilling operations. So, I mean, it's an economic risk that they're taking on.
It's still going on now? Are they still legal as we speak?
Oh, deep sea drilling? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Deepwater Horizon is underwater, but there are lots of other ultra deep drilling rigs like this. In fact, the whole Gulf of Mexico, within the Gulf, all the territories of viable drilling operations have already been mapped out and sold to all the. So BP has a stake on that land for any oil that it pulls up, and they're still all out there. In fact, it was 6 months. There was a moratorium for 6 months, I believe, after the oil spill. And I think BP was able to get that moratorium removed after 3 months and to go back out there and start drilling some more.
It's just crazy how, like, in the scenario, when you mess up that bad, you're just done. Your career's over. Nobody's giving you a chance. But this corporation can make the biggest mistake that could have been prevented, and they just said okay, and they actually have the they're actually bold enough to, like, oh, you know what, you gotta lift this so we can get back to work. what other area in life can you, besides I guess the economy with banks and stuff, how they could just recover and keep going even though they made huge mistakes? We just allow them so much privilege.
Yeah, I mean, I almost understand it a little bit more with banks, because the economic impact is sort of distantly related to people's lives. But in this case, the thing actually exploded. It killed 11 people. There's no way that your career is going to be unaffected if you are found killing 11 people. But for a corporation, BP is still one of the largest oil companies in the world. It's still doing lots of drilling exactly like this. The problem, it even gets worse than this, because BP has this track record of not being safe, and then they cause this big explosion. And instead of holding them accountable for this directly, instead what happens is that they're given total rein over the cleanup effort. So basically Obama hands over the Coast Guard and all of our cleanup equipment. We basically just hand it over to BP so that they can run the cleanup effort themselves. We put the company responsible for the mess in charge of cleaning up the mess. And we gave them almost carte blanche, where they could do basically whatever they want with very little oversight from the public. BP closed down all the beaches when they would have their cleaning operations, and they wouldn't let anyone look, including members of the local community, members of the media, to actually see what they were doing. So how they were handling the cleanup and what they were doing was sort of outside of public vision at the time. And it turns out that what they were doing was releasing the stuff called Core Exit. So here's the thing about an oil spill. It looks really bad, and it looks really bad from space. Like, if you fly things over the oil spill, you can see the oil spill very clearly. This is just the surface oil, so it's not really the extent of the damage. Remember, this is all stuff coming up from an exposed oil head on the bottom of the ocean. But this is just what's made it to the surface. The thing is that it's the stuff on the surface that you can see from your helicopters and your planes. It's the stuff that's on the surface that you see in the news media. So in order to combat this perception, BP decided to dump a bunch of Core Exit. So Core Exit, it's an oil dispersant. The idea is that it helps oil clumps together. Presumably that's supposed to help it make it easier to clean up. And so they dumped like 1.8 million gallons of dispersant flying overhead, dumping this dispersant on the water. And they also injected dispersant right at the oil leaks. And again, the idea is that the dispersant is supposed to help the oil clump together so you can clean it up easier. But there's problems here. So for one thing, Core Exit is more toxic than the oil itself. More significant ecological and environmental damage happened from the dumping of the Core Exit in the environment than from the actual dumping of the oil. Moreover, Core Exit hadn't been approved and hadn't even really been tested for its environmental or ecological side effects. Right? We didn't know what the stuff was going to do to the ecology. All we really knew that it was going to do was it's going to take the oil off the surface. And that's what BP wanted to do. So BP dumped a bunch of this toxic material that's more poisonous than the actual oil that was being dumped. They dump all this stuff into the water in order to get it off the surface so you can't see it when you're taking pictures so that the press isn't so bad. This stuff didn't actually make the cleanup any easier. In fact, it made the cleanup a lot worse. So one of the strategies for doing cleanup are to run these skimmers over the water, and the skimmers are supposed to like sort of sweep up the top layer and get all the oil. But the thing is that when you dump the Core Exit on it, it clumps up and the oil falls to the bottom of the ocean, and then the skimmers don't work anymore. And so now on the bottom floor of the Gulf of Mexico, there's like a layer of oil. And that layer of oil is an ecological nightmare. A lot of the recycling of nutrients happens from bottom feeders, animals that live on the bottom that digest all the falling food and plant and animal matter and so on. And all those creatures don't have space to work in anymore. Core Exit, it's not just toxic to the environment, but it's also toxic to human beings. And we, again, this stuff just, it hasn't been studied, so we don't know what happens when Core Exit ends up in the food chain. We do know that all the fisheries have collapsed, so all the Gulf Coast fisheries and shrimping farms and so on, those don't work anymore. All those communities that rested on the Gulf for their survival, for their livelihoods.
Did Core Exit kill any humans at all?
We don't know about that. We're still doing toxicity studies of how far this stuff has gotten into the food chain. Part of the problem here is that we just don't know. A lot of this stuff is still coming out. This research is still coming out about the extent of the damage. I do know that we're finding Core Exit and we're finding remnants of this oil spill as far north as Greenland. We found it all up and down the east coast of the United States and Canada, and all the way up to Greenland. So this stuff has gotten into the global supply, global oceans. And BP did this with almost no oversight, with no regulatory oversight. In fact, the EPA had to keep telling BP to stop dumping all this car exit because we didn't know what it does. It hasn't been studied well enough. And they use millions of gallons of this stuff. Okay, so Hook talks about the worst case scenario. Smith talks about the economic consequences for the fishing in wildlife communities in the Gulf, for other for the tourist industry, and for other kinds of communities and industries and economic situations in the Gulf Coast. What are the damages? The Smith article is a few years old, and I know some of the legal settlements have just come out within the last year or 6 months or so. So if you want to update some of these figures from these articles, I'd like to see information. Naomi Klein writes this article, A Hole in the World. It's an investigative journalism article, mostly talking to the fishing and gaming communities out on the Gulf Coast and how angry they are with BP and with the government, right? We don't trust you guys. Let me give a little bit of a political thing. So I don't know if you remember. Yeah, I don't know if you remember the 2008 election campaign. This was John McCain and Sarah Palin on the Republican ticket. And so after 2008, in the run-up to the 2010 midterm elections and the 2012 presidential election, there were worries about these drilling operations. And the Republicans were very gung-ho about these drilling operations, that we need to drill. We need to drill because the price of oil was rising, and we needed, for economic reasons, we needed to have cheap gas. And the way to get cheap gas was to drill locally, is stop relying on foreign oil. This is still an issue in the political debates today. Too much reliance on foreign oil, not enough reliance on our own resources here at home. And so the Republicans, from 2008 to 2010, were pushing this really hard with the slogan, Drill, Baby, Drill. Newt Gingrich started the slogan, and then Sarah Palin says over and over again, drill, baby, drill. And the idea is to get these drilling operations going, cut out all the regulations that are holding them back, let them drill so we can get cheap gas. The Republicans were pushing this very hard, but so was the oil industry, the lobbyists. And Obama gave in, and yes, with cosmic bad timing, just 3 weeks before the Deepwater Horizon blew up, the president announced that he would open up previously protected parts of the country to offshore drilling. The practice is not as risky as he thought, he explained. Oil rigs today generally don't cause spills. They're very technologically advanced. Just three weeks before the largest oil spill in history, Obama opens up more oil farms to work and makes the claim that these rigs are very, very safe. They don't cause spills. This was what the lobbyists had been arguing for months, that these things are safe, that the regulations are too strict. You don't need all these worst case scenario regulations. You need to remove the regulations so we can get to our drilling. And it worked, and Obama says that they're very safe. And then 3 weeks later, worst oil spill in history. Right? This shows the impact that the corporate environment has on regulations. We saw this already with the Ford Pinto, right? I mean, technically Ford was acting legally, they were acting within the regulatory requirements, but Ford was also partly responsible for setting those regulatory environments. They had been lobbying to keep those regulations as minimal as possible, so it's no surprise that they were acting within the law because they partly helped set the law, right? I mean, this is the real, just to reinforce this, last week we talked a little bit about compliance versus integrity, that if there's rules, just doing the bare minimum to meet the rules is compliance, and then you're technically okay because you meet the rules, but there's a difference between compliance and integrity. Integrity, you do the thing because you understand why the rules are there. You know, maybe we can debate about this or that particular rule, and whether it's too harsh or can be let up a little bit, But the point of the rules is to ensure safety, and integrity is doing what's required to ensure safety, sort of independent of the rules. I mean, you meet the minimum standards, but you also go beyond those standards because you know that that's what's required for safety. So mere compliance is only doing, right? So like on your essays, mere compliance is writing 350 words exactly, because that's the requirement. And if you've written 350 words, then you've met the minimum requirements. But actual integrity requires writing more than 350 words. This is why if you've been writing 350 words in your essays, you've been getting B's, because it's showing that you're only willing to do the minimal effort and you're not willing to actually do the effort required to learn. Especially the students who write their essays with 350 words on the dot. I tend to grade those pretty harshly because it shows sort of mere interest in compliance and no integrity. But in some ways, the BP oil spill and the Ford Pinto case are worse than mere compliance because they're also working to move the order of compliance as low as possible. So sort of actively working against what's required for integrity, right? If the goal is to be safe, then they're actively undermining the very protocols to keep us safe. And this is very frustrating. It's incredibly frustrating that not only do they do this and get away with it, but after doing and getting away with it, they're put in charge of the cleanup effort. So really, the public has very little resources for contesting this kind of thing. Smith with the economic analysis, Hook with the regulatory environment, Klein talks to the local communities, and Ingersoll gives you the inside decision-making process. The other two things that I have on the website, as far as resources, are these two documentaries. One is BBC Horizons and one is the In Focus documentary. And these two documentaries give you two different sides of the story. The first one says the BP oil spill, the untold story. By untold story, what they mean is BP's side of the story. This documentary, it's almost entirely focused on what they did to address the oil spill as it was happening. This huge technical challenge. They didn't know what to do. It was a big engineering effort with all these experts. And that's basically all this documentary talks about. But in the process, you see the lead engineers who are responsible for the disaster relief and a bunch of the top management and CEOs at BP. They all give interviews for this video because the documentary is very kind to them. The documentary doesn't talk at all about the situations that led to the disaster. And it doesn't talk at all about the cleanup effort afterwards. It's really just about what did we do while the disaster was happening. The documentary, it makes BP look like they're really technically sophisticated and, you know, trying to meet this very hard challenge and sort of this engineering success story. But they don't talk about any of the difficulties.
So is that video kind of a waste of time? Because they're just trying to show, I mean, the most important part we're trying to figure out is what was the main cause of this? I mean, how we're going to resolve it, that's kind of, I think, politically corrupt, because you shouldn't give power to a company who made that mistake. Someone needs to be above them, and the government seems just to give that away, so.
Yeah, I don't think the video is a waste of time. So I think you're right about why this is problematic. But I don't think it's a waste of time. In particular, it lets you see sort of up close what it's like from their perspective, why they think that they deserve this power. The other thing that you see is the fact that they have access to the executives and the CEO to do these interviews. They're not going to get that kind of access if they're telling a critical story. You have to tell a positive story in order to get the access to the people that you want to talk to. So there's also a sort of media lesson in here, right? The fact that they can do an interview with these top BP executives is because they're not being very harsh to the BP executives. There's this other documentary, this In Focus documentary, that looks at all the stuff, at all the other stuff. So the regulatory environment, Hook, who gives this article on the regulatory environment, he's interviewed in this documentary, and he sort of rants about the government and how corrupt they are, the oil industry and so on. A lot of rants about that. There's also a lot of discussion of the core exit, the use of core exit, the environmental damage it caused. There's a lot of interviews with scientists. There's also interviews with this guy at the beginning. Not that person. Yeah, this guy on the left here, I think the person on the right is the wife, but the person on the left was one of the engineers at BP on the oil rig when it exploded. And he was there, I think he had medical costs afterwards, and he had a hard time getting BP to pay for those medical costs, even acknowledged there was something that they were responsible for. And so you see the way that BP treats its employees, the way that BP handles the spill from sort of the other sides of the story. I want you to consider both of these documentaries and try to come to a full picture from all perspectives of what's happening. Do this not just to really get to the bottom of the BP oil spill, but do this also to think more generally about the way that media reports on these disasters and how these reports can be biased in different ways. You should be thinking about this for your own research. When you're doing your own research on your own case, some of the material that you're going to see is going to be biased in one way or the other, and you should at least have in mind thinking about what is the source, what are the incentives that they have for reporting in this way, and so on. I will caution you, because there's a Deepwater Horizon movie right now. I think Kurt Russell's in it. I don't know. There's a Deepwater Horizon movie right now, and so it's kind of in the news all over the place, and there's a lot of really terrible reporting. So be on the lookout for that kind of stuff. This is one of the reasons why I had to link to a Daily Motion video as opposed to a YouTube video, because this first documentary was taken off of YouTube a couple of weeks ago.
Beneath the waves.
So, but it should be here, and I have another copy of it if this one goes away.
Why are they taking the videos off? Why are the videos coming off of YouTube?
Copyright infringement. It was just uploaded by someone, but it's a BBC documentary. We don't want people to see it.
These engineers that work for BP and the employees that work for BP, that must be, it reminds me of the following the script lesson, because how can they go on, you know, like being comfortable with themselves if they really look at the situation objectively? They must have some kind of rationalization of, you know, that it was necessary. You know, they have to have a way of rationalizing such a horrible thing that they were involved in. Because, I mean, I'm sure they're very smart people. They could have foreseen something like this possibly happening. And the schema there must have been such that they just thought they were so good or something like that. Or the work was so important that they just gave them carte blanche. Like, it's, you know, I don't know how they felt so empowered to do this, knowing that the possible risk. I guess they have some kind of, you know, perception is reality type of deal.
Yeah, part of it is also they believed that BP would take care of that. So it was probably like, you know, if I'm doing my job well and something bad happens and it wasn't my fault, then they thought they would be taken. If it wasn't my fault that something bad happened, that I would be taken care of, that I would be compensated properly, that, you know, my medical expenses would be taken care of and so on. If it wasn't my fault, if it was BP's fault, then you might think that they would have some respect for their employees and treat them fairly, but that's not what they did. So after this disaster, BP, you know, the lawyers come out and giving medical expenses to employees like this can be construed as an admission of guilt, and that might be problematic for the other lawsuits they have going on. Very quickly, you see that BP has very little loyalties to its. I mean, corporations demand loyalty from its employees, but they have very little loyalty back. Where if you know, shit hits the fan, then they're willing to fire off all their low-level employees very quickly. We see this over and over again. We saw this with Wells Fargo, right? Big major scandal is coming from the top, but the way that they deal with it is firing everyone on the bottom. There's a ton more to say about this case. There's a lot of interesting stuff. The one thing that I haven't mentioned yet, I just wanted to mention quickly, is this Knopka article. I have it as an optional article, but Knopka talks about integrity in an ecological sense. When you're reading about the disaster, the oil spill disaster, Yeah, so on the Wikipedia page, efforts to stem the Deepwater Horizon oil spill, it talks right at the very top of it. It says various species of dolphins and mammals, 61 casualties, birds, 2,000 casualties, sea turtles, 460 casualties. This is typically how we end up talking about the disaster. We talk about it in quantitative terms. We talk about how much oil was spilled, how many things died, and so on. And the point that Kanopka makes in this article is that in order to understand the extent of the damage, you can't just list the number of animals that died, but you have to really understand how it impacted the overall ecology, and in particular, how it undermined the integrity of the ecology. So we've been talking about integrity a little bit in class already. Integrity is the thing that holds the system together so that it can maintain itself over time. And the idea here is that, it's not just that 61 dolphins died. It's not that just that we're sad that the dolphins died, but it's that the dolphins serve an important ecological role in that they fill an ecological niche in that ecology. And without the top predators, then the whole food pyramid collapses, right? Or so on the top layer of the ocean, you have the autotrophs that are photosynthesizing from the sun. I mean, those autotrophs are making. It's like the grass in the ground. That's the basic food that all the other animals eat from, or they get their food from in some way. So when you kill off the autotroph layer with a bunch of corrective on the surface of the water, then it kills the whole food pyramid and the whole ecology collapses. And the problem isn't just that individuals died. It's not just that 61 dolphins died, as if the thing that we care about is the dolphins. I mean, you might like dolphins, but the point isn't the dolphins themselves. It's the whole ecology. And those dolphins perform an important role. Right, so, if I cut a pound of flesh out, and that pound of flesh happens to be your heart, well, that makes a big deal. And it's not just because it's a pound of flesh, but because your heart plays an important role. You might be able to cut a pound of flesh from your thigh without it hurting as much, but your heart is a vital organ, and that's the worry, is that you when these kinds of ecological disasters don't just kill off a lot of things, but they damage the vital organs that the whole system runs on. So the Gulf Coast is this super nutrient-rich part of the planet, and the Gulf Stream takes all these rich nutrients from the Gulf Coast and moves them all the way across the Atlantic into, like, England, up north, northern Europe. And that Gulf Stream that moves all these nutrients, it basically feeds the entire Atlantic Ocean. In other words, this isn't just a local ecological disaster. This affects the whole global ecology. And understanding the relationship between all these delicate parts and how they all fit together, again, this is a matter of integrity. And so Kanopka analyzes the Deepwater Horizon oil spill in terms of the integrity, the cost of the integrity of the ecosystem. These kinds of considerations will help us out a lot when we get to next week with the geoengineering cases. But I think that's all I want to say today. I think we're out of time. Does anyone have any other questions or comments, thoughts you have?
I got one. Like, there's so much information here. How do you suggest we go back? We go about doing the assignment? Like, there's so much stuff. What would you do to do this assignment?
In general, this is for all the things. I give more resources than you can really work through comprehensively. So you should find something that you're interested in. Are you interested in the environmental damage? Are you interested in the government regulations? Are you interested in the technical, what happened to the rig? Right? So find your point of interest and then start looking at the stuff with that interest in mind. I think the easiest thing to do is to watch the documentaries. It'll give you a good entryway into the resources. I think the best source of all of these is the Ingersoll article. That's the most comprehensive, and it gives you the most details of what actually happened to cause the oil spill. So I would say if you're starting and feeling a little bit lost, look at the documentaries first, look at the Ingersoll article first, and then the rest of them, just look at them for your quiz or whatever. The Ingersoll article in particular is really good. The Hook article is also pretty good. Good. Any other questions, comments? Thank you very much, everyone. I will see you all next week.
All right, take care. Thank you.
Thanks, Professor. Take care.
Yeah.